All God's children together, trying to see where we belong, with hills and valleys to conquer. It's time we weather the storm. Everybody's looking for something, something they can hold on to. Well, good morning. Thank you, Brother Wes, and good morning to all of you. Hope you had a great weekend. Thank you for joining us for another edition of Mayor's Moment. Before we introduce our very special guest today, we'd just like to remind you that you can tune in and watch the Mayor's Moment and previous episodes on our YouTube channel, as well as our podcast is shared on all the various networks of Spotify, iTunes, and others. But the link is on the website, on the social media site for Mayor Mitch Colvin's Facebook page. Make sure you like the page. Your information is power, so we want to make sure that you're informed. Each week we attempt to kind of bring you an up-to-date look at the local activities or anything that is pressing us on, from a local policy or perspective. And also we bring in guests from all across the state and the country who share very valuable information with us. Today I am happy to have with me in studio Dr. Henry McKoy, who is the Director of Entrepreneurship, the School of Business, and Managing Director of Eagle Angel Network at North Carolina Central. Good morning, Doctor.
Good morning, Mayor. How you doing?
I'm doing well, sir. And also joining us remotely is Mr. Kevin Dick. He is statewide community leader for Carolina Small Business Development Fund, CDFI, a statewide community lender nonprofit. He's the new president and CEO. Good morning, Mr. Dick. How are you, sir? I think we may have a little audio technical issues that we'll work through to get Mr. Dick in plugged into the conversation. But in the meantime, we hope that you all had a great weekend, a safe weekend. We know that this past weekend there were a number of 20-year anniversary commemorations of the tragic events of 9/11. It's hard to believe it happened 20 years ago. Dr. McKoy, you remember what you were doing 20 years ago when doing 9/11?
Yeah, I think it's one of those moments that I think you always remember where you were actually at when you started hearing it. I was in banking at the time in Durham, and I was actually just getting to work because I had something that morning, and I pulled into the parking lot, and I was listening to the radio. And at that time, it was still unknown really what was going on. The first plane had went to the building, and the DJs were trying to kind of explain it. And yeah, it's something that sticks with you. I remember going into the bank on the corporate headquarters, and It was a little bit of chaos, and so I won't forget it. And as you said, I mean, me and my family spent a whole lot of time this past weekend and week just watching the memorial.
Absolutely, and so as you said, you never forget where you were at that time. I think I was at work in the office, and I remember watching it, and initially I thought it was an accident, and then as you're watching live, you see the other plane come in, and it was absolutely you never forget that. And so as we are tempted to get Mr. Kevin Dick online with us, I know that he will need to call in to 910-483-6111 in addition to the video stream, just to get everything. So, Kevin, if you can hear us, if you could call in to the station, 910-483-6111. But Dr. McKoy, while we're waiting on him, tell us a little bit about yourself. And before we came online, I didn't realize you were a Fayetteville guy. So tell us a little bit. And you were an Eagle, that is still affiliated with the Eagles.
Yeah, Douglas Bird Eagle, class of 1991. So, yeah, I hope we get our brother Kevin Dick on. Kevin and I are old friends, and I actually was on the board of Carolina Small Business, which is, the firm that he oversees. But yeah, I was born and raised in Fayetteville. Grew up here. My family's still here. Graduated from Douglas Bird in '91, and went off to college. You went to UNC Chapel Hill, and pretty much been in the Triangle since. I live in Durham, but you know, my family's still in Fayetteville, and so as I was mentioning to you before, Mayor, you know, they always love when I get a chance to be on WIDU because my dad gets a chance to fix up the guest room and come home and crash with him, and he always takes me out and feeds me too much, so always happy to come back to the Ville.
That's right, Ben. So, 91, I graduated, but I was across town over here at Eads Smith. So, that is very interesting. I think we have Mr. Kevin Dick. Kevin, can you hear us, sir?
I can. Good morning, Mr. Mayor. Can you hear me?
We can hear you. Thank you for joining us. We were just getting started. Dr. McKoy kind of gave us a little bit about his background. I didn't know he was a local homeboy, but he's in the Durham area now. But tell us a little bit about yourself.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Mayor, for having me. Really appreciate the opportunity to be on with you and my old friend, Dr. McKoy. You hearing feedback?
Okay. Sounds good. Yes, sir.
Yeah, so unlike you all, I'm not a native North Carolinian, but I have been in the state for 16 years now. Originally grew up in the Northeast, born in Brooklyn, grew up in New Jersey, spent some time in South Florida before moving to North Carolina, so that makes me a halfback. I moved all the way to the bottom and moved halfway back. Have had the privilege of working with two local governments, City of Durham, City of Charlotte, prior to taking this role as President and CEO of Carolina Small Business Development Fund. Moved to the Triangle originally, moved to Charlotte, moved back. So I guess I have like a lot of boomerang type perspectives in my background. So I'm happy to be here. Thank you.
Yeah, same here. I heard a lot about you. Jay Reinstein, I guess, is the common denominator between the three of us. And Jay was very passionate about to make sure that we connected. He worked with us for a while. I enjoyed working with Jay even before becoming mayor. I was mayor pro tem and worked very closely with him. Wish him well in his new endeavors. But he said that you guys have a lot to offer that could benefit our community. Dr. McKoy, I know you being a Fayetteville native, tell us a little bit about what you do at NCCU and how you think some of those resources can make their way to our community.
Yeah, well, I think, you know, again, coming from Fayetteville and watching it over the years, I mean, you've been here, you've seen how it's grown and how it's changed, but it certainly is this kind of gateway into the Southeast. At North Classic University, we do a lot of it, from a similarity standpoint. Fayetteville State is our sister institution. I had a chance to serve on the board of visitors and advisors for the School of Business at Fayetteville State for a number of years, and School of Education. And so, I know the kind of resources that you guys have there. At NCCU, I get a chance to, get up every day and what I do, what I hope is meaningful work, and we have a number of programs that are really focused on how do we impact particularly minority businesses and underrepresented minorities, particularly African Americans. And so there's a couple of programs that are particularly focused around that, and one is you mentioned I'm the managing director of what we call the Ego Angel Network, and the Angel Network is really a place where early stage entrepreneurs can get access to capital. You have kind of an idea that you're trying to get off the ground. What we do at the Eagle Angel Network is try to connect you to early stage capital. We're a part of what was called a Triangle Venture Alliance, which is North Classic University, Duke University, UNC Chapel Hill, and Duke University, NC State University. And so we work in that aspect of getting access to capital. The second piece is around access to information and technical assistance. And this is probably going to end up sounding a lot like, Kevin and some of the work he does, even though they do it on a much bigger scale. For us, that technical assistance piece, we have a group of students and fellows that really work with entrepreneurs
and even local governments who are trying to figure out how to create more equitable outcomes, right? You know, how do you make sure that your minority entrepreneurs are really getting a fair shot? How do you help them get their businesses straight and grow and scale? And so for us, I guess kind of those two anchor pieces are, really access to really early stage capital, and secondly is kind of technical assistance and help for both businesses and local governments trying to create more equitable outcomes.
Well, that's great, and I want to zero back in on a couple of things you said. So you are kind of on serving two roles. So your angel aspect is kind of like an angel investor for if you have a great idea, but you provide the capital. A lot of people have a lot of wonderful ideas, but they don't have the finances and the resources to bring those to reality. Are those programs specific to people who live in the Triangle, or are students to NCCU or anyone?
Well, so the angel network is exactly what you said. I mean, the idea is to be a part of kind of this angel group that helps you develop early stage ideas. Our particular program generally focuses on students at NCCU and folks from the Durham community. However, we do have a network. I mean, there's angel networks across the state, and so what we try to do for folks who aren't in those particular category of people, we try to connect them to other capital. And it begins. I mean, it's pretty important, particularly for the Black community, because we don't often have the same kind of friends or family networks that give that early stage investment that some other groups do. And so what we try to do is, again, for those who aren't in the Durham or NCCU area, we try to connect them to broader networks around the state that we're connected to.
Absolutely. And Mr. Dick, tell us a little bit about the organization that you're with, Carolina Small Business Development Fund, but you've also served in local government as an economic developer. Tell us a little bit about what you do and how your program works.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Mayor. So I think a common theme, as Dr. McKoy said, would be equity, right? So Carolina Small Business Development Fund is a 31-year-old organization. It started out as the North Carolina Minority Support Center. And when it was founded in 1990, there were two goals, really, to provide financial and technical assistance to community-based credit unions and to minority deposit institutions, so basically banks owned by or controlled by people of color. And, around the time of the Great Recession, obviously the whole financial industry, services industry, went sort of topsy-turvy, right? Everything in terms of banking, a lot of consolidation, bank closures and things. And so Carolina, at the time, the support center elected to pivot in its focus and start to concentrate on direct lending to small business. And so started doing that around 2010, 2011. And then in 2013, we received a designation, which we currently hold and which is very significant for what we do. We were designated as a community development financial institution by the U.S. Department of Treasury. And effectively what that meant is that we as a 501c3 nonprofit could lend money with an emphasis on underserved communities, businesses owned by people of color, female-owned businesses, veterans, those who identify as low to moderate income. These are groups that have traditionally lacked access to capital from the traditional banking system. And so what we do and what we've done since then and what we continue to do today is partner with banks, philanthropic organizations, increasingly during the pandemic, also with public sector organizations like municipalities and state, county government, state government, and really get money that we somehow obtain from those sources I mentioned, get that money out to small business. Unlike Dr. McKoy, even though I think what we're doing is very complementary, our focus tends to be more on businesses that have at least a 2 to 3 year track record, but generally under 20 employees, annual revenue, some usually $2 million or less. So we are looking to lend and provide technical assistance. Those are two of our key pillars. The third pillar is policy and research. And that's one of the things that sets us apart from other CDFIs. We do a lot of policy and research work about the impacts that small businesses are having on the state economy, as well as the impacts that events like the pandemic, hurricanes, and so forth have on small business. So this is important information for policymakers to know, elected officials like yourself, banking officials, those in the arena of having the influence and the ability to direct resources towards small business assistance. And so since 2011, we have closed roughly 1,100 loans statewide. Last year, during the pandemic, we also started administering grant programs and loan programs for municipalities, as I said earlier. And through that activity, we actually did 835 grants last year as well. So between the 1,100 loans, 835 grants, we've deployed over $79 million in capital in the state, which has leveraged other private investments as well. And, you know, as it relates to Fayetteville specifically, we have a partnership with Fayetteville State that we are looking to really sort of reestablish after the pandemic, you know, when a lot of things weren't in person, a little bit more difficult. But we really, I think, strengthened our muscles in terms of doing a lot of virtual and remote activities with potential small businesses. I know that historically, most of our loans are somewhere between $5,000 and $250,000, and the average is generally about $75,000. So I know historically, based on the last numbers I looked, we had probably lent somewhere around $3 million in Fayetteville. I know we've done hundreds of hours of technical assistance. And as I said, with the partnership with Fayetteville State, we are looking to really be very intentional about getting capital and technical assistance out to Fayetteville area and Cumberland County small business.
Yeah, wow. That was good to hear. You said a lot that kind of piqued my interest. One is, the impact that it's had when you all used to, in the early 90s, work with, black-owned banks and credit unions. I mean, who's left? I know we had a black-owned bank here, United National Bank, that sold out to, I think, Omni, that's later become First Horizon. But and then we had a credit union here. But what have you seen? What's the lay of the land look like with black-owned financial institutions?
It is a lot. It's a lot less prevalent than it was then, and not just in the state, but nationally. I believe the number nationally is down, and Dr. McKoy may know this figure as well. I believe the number nationally is down to something like 18 banks throughout the country, 18 black-owned banks.
Yeah, something like that.
There's also now an emergence, given the population shifts, there's a strong emergence of Latino-owned banks. So within North Carolina, you have several branches of Mechanics and Farmers. Used to have Mutual Savings Bank that consolidated into Mechanics and Farmers. You have the Latino Credit Union, Community Credit Union. They have branches throughout the state. But I don't really, Dr. McKoy may know otherwise, but I don't really think there are too many black-owned banks other than Mechanics and Farmers. And in terms of deposit institutions where you can walk in and have an account, that's one thing I want to point out. We are not a bank,
right. But
we're a community development financial institution ourselves that supports black businesses. But I don't think there's too many black-owned banks left.
Yeah. Wow. That's significant. And I want to ask this question to both of you. You know, I'm a business owner. Been in business since 1995. You know, purchased my parents' place, and getting capital was tough. I tell the story sometime. You know, the first loan I took out for the business, or the purchase of the business, it was like at 17-18% from a thrift bank.
in Maryland, you know, and I had a broker that arranged it, so they got 8 or 10%. It was real tough money, but you needed it. Didn't have credit. COVID has had a tremendous impact, period, on the economy, but particularly for black-owned businesses. How have you guys seen, what's the impact of COVID look like, Dr. McKoy, from business owners? And then, Kevin, I'll ask you the same question.
Yeah, well, I think that, you know, one thing that is critical to think about is, you know, the question of where were black businesses before COVID, right? I mean, there were so many challenges. And as you mentioned, this idea of, you know, getting access to capital, I mean, you know, that's why what, you know, Kevin does is so important, because at the end of the day, I mean, that's what allows a business to operate and grow, right? Getting access to capital. And we've seen just the discrimination in the capital markets forever. I mean, it's, you know, this is nothing new. And as you said, I mean, you know, your initial loan is like, you know, buying your parents' business on a credit card, right? I mean,
right.
It's an incredible hurdle to get over. Well, I actually just wrote a book chapter. I think the book chapter is coming out, and it's part of a bigger book in the spring through Duke University Press. But the chapter I did was focused on the impact of COVID-19 on African-American businesses across the United States. And so I framed that to say that, you know, when, you know, as the old saying goes, whenever you know, the white community gets a cold, you know, the black community gets pneumonia, and COVID has been no different. And then when you look at the response, the idea of sending the money through these same institutions that have been discriminatory, it just kind of codified that gap in terms of getting access to capital. And so we've seen a tremendous hit to the black community, to the business community, as it relates to, you know, getting access to capital. And so, you know, it's a very different and harsh landscape. And so, I mean, there's going to take a lot to move back, I think, you know, and maybe this is a way to, you know, pivot over to Kevin. I mean, Kevin and the Carolina Small Business Development Fund has been kind of those, you know, the repairs of the breach, right? In the midst of not being able to get capital from traditional banks. So I know in Durham, you know, we partner with Carolina Small Business Development Fund to get capital out to our, you know, minority businesses. And, you know, Kevin can talk about that as he likes, as well as what else he's doing in the state. But as well as, you know, for me and a group of other folks, came together, and really in the early days of the COVID, we put together something called the Thrive Community Fund, which we raised a couple hundred thousand dollars just to kind of very quickly get some money out to black businesses who just couldn't get access to capital right after the pandemic hit. And so I think that access to capital remains that you know, impediment to really you know, getting businesses up and growing in a significant way.
Absolutely. Mr. Dick, what do you think, what's your perspective of COVID and its impact on the clientele that you service?
Well, Mr. Mayor, let me say first that I'm glad you're sitting down, okay? Because I'm going to hit you with a few figures, and I hope everybody's had their coffee, right? There was some study, there was some research work done at the University of California, Santa Cruz, measuring the impact on businesses owned by people of various races, from about February 2020 to April 2020, right? The real, you know, sort of acknowledged start of the pandemic, if you will, on the broader society. Of white-owned small businesses, we'll do a little trivia. What do you think the percentage was of white-owned small business closures?
You said the total percentage of white-owned small businesses?
Right.
Closures, so, or just period?
The total percentage of the closure of all the small businesses that closed, what was, you know, white-owned?
Well, maybe 20, 25, 30%.
Okay. And actually, let me reframe that. It was, of all the white-owned small businesses, what percentage closed? So you weren't too far off. It was 17%.
Okay.
Right? What do you think the percentage was for Asian businesses?
Maybe 10%.
25%.
Oh.
And then, what do you think it was for Hispanic-owned businesses?
Maybe 30-35%.
You right there. You need to play the lottery. For black-owned small businesses, it was 41%.
Wow.
So that means that the rate of closure for black-owned small businesses was 2.5 times that of white-owned small businesses, right? Mm-hmm. So that gives you a picture of, like Dr. McKoy and you said earlier, the whole access to capital piece and really the inequities that were taking place in society pre-pandemic just shown even brighter during the pandemic. We still had a lot of instances historically, access to capital had been tough. So you were fortunate enough to get a loan period. And I'm not discounting the fact paying 17% to 18% interest on a loan shouldn't have to be. But some, a lot of black owned small businesses have had to completely rely upon equity historically. Not having access to the best wealth generating tool that this the U.S. society has to offer, which is home ownership. And so because we lack access to capital in mortgage markets and small business markets, always been tough for black-owned small business. And so the pandemic has, you know, like I said, it's just shown light on a greater problem. And like Dr. McKoy said, what we tried to do was really work with communities and work with small businesses. Mm-hmm. Our DNA is an emphasis on businesses owned by people of color. So 57% of all of the capital that we've gotten out there, whether it be loans or grants, has been to businesses owned by people of color. And of that number, I would say 4 out of every 5 have been black owned businesses. And that's going back about
10. Well, that's great. I mean, I know when the pandemic hit, as you said, if you know, a lot of times the black businesses are on the margins or just one incident away from, because they don't have the lines of credit, they don't have the reserves, they're one incident away from missing payroll, not being able to pay rent, lights going out of business. And they don't have the generational wealth that you can call your dad and have him write a six-figure check to carry you over until things get better. So the city during the pandemic, initially, you know, when the Roof Chris's and those guys were sucking up all of the PPP money, the small guys, if you could find a bank that told you how to do the paperwork to qualify, usually you were at the back of the line. In fact, Bank of America, who was my primary bank for deposits, wasn't even taking applications. I mean, so corporate America had filled all the spaces, and so you had to go to a smaller bank, and the rules were fluid. So it was just a mess. But the city created a micro program while we were waiting on dollars from the state and federal government to push money out. We have a local organization called Seed that helped us facilitate that. 5,000 and less. These were for barbers, beauticians, single member business owners who couldn't go to work. But we'll talk about that a little bit. I'm getting some nudges to go on a break. They have to go and pay some bills. But I'll be right back. This is a great conversation. I want to continue that. We'll be right back on Mayor's Moment. Thank you so much, Brother Wes, and thank you all for joining us today. Again, two very special, knowledgeable guests, Dr. Henry McKoy, who's a Fayetteville native, but is now the Director of Entrepreneurship and the School of Business at North Carolina Central University, and also Mr. Kevin Dick, who is the President and CEO of Carolina Small Business Development, a statewide community lender. And we've been talking a little bit about the challenges of African-American-owned businesses compared to other ethnic group businesses. I mean, we see that there's just a difference. And today we're talking about access to resources, which really is the fuel for the tank. You know, your car really can't do you any good if it doesn't have any gas in it. And so with a business, you can have a great idea. You can have an opportunity. But if you can't get your hands on the resources or the dollars it takes to make it real or to maintain it. So, you know, during the break, kind of mentioned PPP, you know, some of the, you know, and those who are joining us, that was the government's response to COVID, that there was this payroll protection program. Yeah, payroll protection program A lot of it was intended to keep people working, to keep the mass layoffs, you know, small businesses employ a lot of the economy. But a lot of the corporations found a way to get to that. They had these different individual franchises or LLCs that helped them qualify in some way or another. And some of the larger national chains, the Ruth Chris's and those guys, got a lot of money. We were talking about just here in Fayetteville, talked to a local business owner, contractor, has employees, just figured out how to make it through, and said that he kept getting the runaround and couldn't get an application submitted. So he didn't get any money during the PPP. But then I told him of some instances I know of some local people in his same profession that got $5 to $6 million. That creates a huge gap between the competitiveness of his business and the businesses of those, just based on information. And then the government, if you met certain criteria, forgave the loan if you turned in certain paperwork. So really, look, this is free money that came from the federal government, $5 or $6 million that one business received. That was a white-owned business, and a lot of minority businesses had difficulty getting it. Dr. McCoy, you said that you have written a book that kind of addressed that. Tell us a little bit about it.
Yeah, so there's a book that's coming out in spring of 2022, whenever the publishers get it out. And actually, the overall book is about the impact of the COVID on African Americans in general. So a broader aspect, you know, whether everything from health to education to those things. I was asked to write a chapter on the impact on African American businesses. And so where I actually focused on was what you're talking about, this PPP situation, because you got to understand that when the crisis hit, then, you know, the government response was to put out, I mean, somewhere upward of, you know, $300-400 billion for the PPP. That was just the first round. And something you think about what Kevin said in terms of this idea of the percentage of businesses that shut down, 17% white, right around 20% Asian, et cetera, 33% Latino, 41% black businesses. And you have to remember where they started from, right? So 17% of white businesses, there were already an enormous kind of gap in terms of the number of white businesses versus others. So that 17%, though, you know, decent amount, still left an enormous kind of footprint. In terms of black businesses, the shutdown, 41% of the black businesses, almost half of them, starting from a much smaller base, it really devastating. So what ended up with the PPP is that, you know, the kind of argument was, well, hey, we got to get this money out the door extremely quick. You got to get out. We can't wait. We can't be, you know, focused on other things. And so the money ended up going out to, again, a lot of times the traditional lenders. Those lenders basically looked out for their own customers, right? And so the major financial institutions said, well, a lot of them weren't even taking outside applications. They just said, well, look, you know, I mean, who are they going to protect, right? They're going to protect the folks who have the loans with them. The other thing that is to be known is actually after that first round of PPP went out, and there was so much kind of up in arms because it didn't go out in a very equitable way. Folks said, well, look, you need to do something and focus on getting this into the hands of, you know, black and brown folks, veterans, and other folks like that. But even when Congress passed the law that said, okay, this next round of PPP, which was another few hundred billion dollars, needs to go target these particular groups, it did not happen. I mean, there's a report that shows that the SBA, who's the one that essentially administered the PPP, they didn't follow the congressional guide, which said, hey, you need to focus on minority and black-owned businesses and other underrepresented businesses. And so even whenever you had a congressional mandate, it still didn't hit the street the way it was supposed to. And, you know, and I say one of the last things I say about that is that the way you mentioned some of these rules and regulations that were put in place as it relates to how the money went out and things like that, there were a number of rules that went out, for example, around things such as, you know, how businesses that essentially took dividends out of their company, which a lot of times, I mean, if you're a small business, instead of taking a regular salary, you may take a dividend,
right?
Because, you know, that's the way you get money out. Those businesses a lot of times ended up being ineligible for being able to get PPP loans because they don't have the traditional payroll kind of aspects. And so it just kind of exacerbated the challenge and issues that we saw. And I guess the final thing I say about that is, as we were talking in the break, you know, we often look at government as being part of the, solution per se to how do we close inequities. But in fact, sometimes the way things operate, they actually exacerbate inequities. And this is one of those cases of PPP where the action of the federal government and how they actually got the money out to the street actually didn't close the gap that we already had. It actually widened the gap.
Well, you know, that goes to a point before I go to Kevin to ask him something about his view of PPP as a direct lender. You know, 2020 not only brought about, I call it a stress test. It showed us that we have significant disparities in healthcare, significant disparities in business and economics, significant disparities in education. All of that was front and center. Then you had the George Floyd issue, who really made the world pay attention to it. Corporate America finally, I think, heard and was able and had to face some of these things. But it starts with the policies that the policymakers who we vote in make. These are the rules that are created that the government uses its resources, its full faith and power to do, which create these gaps that you're saying, that you talked about. That and our goal here is to make sure that people know the information, know the rules. That was the biggest thing about it. We didn't have the information that gave us the rules to how to go about it. And by the time we found it out, the program had changed. Treasury changed the rules two or three times. Those little micro programs, I've talked to a lot of people who benefited from it. 95% of the people, I think we put out maybe 70 loans and maybe $300,000 or $400,000 quickly. But 95% of the folks were minorities who that's all they could get to continue to buy food to go on the table. So, Mr. Dick, from your perspective as a lender, did you guys receive money like the banks to push out? How did your distribution of dollars go last year doing with the PPP, or did you have small businesses that applied through your company?
So, Mr. Mayor, we did not participate as a PPP lender. What we did instead was actually work with different public sector organizations before PPP really got rolled. So the SBA started talking about PPP and another program, EIDL. Right. A lot of small businesses may be familiar with that, the Economic Injury Disaster Loan Program. Both of those things were announced by SBA in around April of 2020 or maybe March, but they didn't really get started until the summer. And so what we did was we partnered with some city, county, and state organizations to start administering their loan program. Dr. McKoy referenced the Durham program, for example. So this is like sort of an alternative to PPP if you were in those particular places. But I think one of the things, I mean, both of you have been spot on. To talk about small businesses, you have to talk not just about the financial capital, but there's really three forms of capital, right, that are very important to small business success. You have the financial capital. You also have social capital. Who do you know? Who do you have relationships with? As we said before, black businesses, whether through legal means or through informal means, have typically not had strong banking relationships, right? And when I say through legal means, I mean that there was a time in this country where the law allowed and created an atmosphere where black folks could not get bank accounts in commercial, in large commercial. So what that created is, and we used this term before, a generational situation where there was just lack of social capital, lack of relationships with banks. So not just about having a bank account, by having a bank. And white-owned small businesses often have a banker, and black-owned small businesses don't. So there's the lack of social capital, and there's also the lack of knowledge capital. One of the things that we did do related to PPP was we had people on staff who got to know the program very well, and they were able to provide technical assistance about walking through the application, also with even talking about the tax implications. A lot of people don't think about the fact that, all right, you get a loan, you're going to get it forgiven. That could be a significant income impact or implication on your business as well. So there's the knowledge capital, the social capital, and the financial capital that were important and that were all disparate pre-pandemic and certainly during the pandemic. But, in terms of how PPP works and the EIDL. Yeah, we heard a lot of about a lot of inconsistencies. We heard about certain businesses who seem to fit the exact intent of the program and be qualified who didn't get PPP. And then we heard about other businesses who did and who you would think wouldn't necessarily need disaster
right.
assistance that got it. And they got it, to your point, in the millions of dollars. So
right.
there, you know, these are things that I think that the SBA, they've taken a hit. They've taken a beating for it. You know, we are a partner of the SBA as well. You know, we have some lending programs that are connected to them. But, you know, there were other really small businesses had to find different alternatives if they couldn't find PPP.
Right. Well, yeah, I mean, and you know, and I'm sure we can really talk about this for another hour because I'm, you know, but what I want to make sure that that people get out of our conversation today with you two is how do they participate? You know, we received some money from American Rescue Plan, roughly 41 million. The county received roughly 67 million. And so we are working together to make sure that we create a program here locally in Fayetteville, Cumberland County that helps all aspects of this recovery situation. So we on the city council, you know, have assigned three committees, one of which is a small business and economic development. The other is housing and neighborhood reinvestment, and the other being infrastructure. So we've had our staff pour through the rules of how to use this money. So we will need partnerships with agencies kind of like CDFI, or we have a local agency here, but we want to make sure that we remove whatever bureaucracy there is that exists when we have to write a check to individuals, and you all are already set up and capable and have the staff and means to push money out on the street. If I am a small business, I'm listening to Mayor's Moment today, I have an idea, either my business closed or I want to start a new business, or my business needs funding for something that we need to do. Kevin, how do we get up with you? What's my process? Do I have to go through Fayetteville State, or can I go directly to you guys?
No, you can come directly to us. CarolinaSmallBusiness.org. We've got, if you go on that website, you'll see a link to program, and there's a request for counseling form. That'll start the process, because that will enable us to know what some of the specific issues and needs you have as a small business, whether it's access to capital, that knowledge capital, because that's the one thing we do, Mr. Mayor. We're not just interested in cutting the check for the loan. It comes with the technical assistance so that we can partner with you as a small business. Look at your financials on a periodic basis. Make sure that maybe you have some good marketing strategies for getting your product or service out the door. And a host of other technical assistance needs. So we want to really couple that type of assistance. But you can go on CarolinaSmallBusiness.org, go to programs and hit request for counseling. Here's the other strong piece of advice I would provide. If you are not certified as a historically underutilized business with the state or a disadvantaged business enterprise with the State Department of Transportation, get certified. One of the things we're participating in now is a grant program with the State Department of Administration. And you talked about American Rescue Plan money. I will say that there with the CARES Act, which you also were familiar with last year, the state is still trying to move some of that money. And some of that is through what we call Retool NC. It's round three. I believe, and you know, it's not fully open now, but it will be shortly. So this is sort of like, you know, hot off the presses. I know we're working with the state. We're partnering that program, working with the state to figure out how to reopen it fully. But this will enable small businesses to get grants of up to $15,000 for 3 months of operating expenses, whichever is less. So that's a way to get a small amount, but but free and easy capital quickly. And then in conjunction with that, at Carolina Small Business, we like to work with these small businesses to see if perhaps they have even a greater capital need, and then we can work with them on really competitive financing. It's like what I like to call it's not prime, but it's not predatory.
Okay. Oh yeah. Well, I definitely know about that. That's a great thing. So CarolinaSmallBusiness.org. So you have the support that businesses need to make sure they're successful when they get the resources to make sure that their product and marketing is correct, and that the underutilized business. One thing that intimidates us a lot of times when these programs are created, we don't participate because of the paperwork piece, but you guys can point them in the right direction to help them get certified, hub certified, and so forth. So you guys, the government is an excellent way. Once you have the paperwork behind you, that is a great business client or customer. We've created local programs here to say that the money that the city of Fayetteville spends, we target 30% to 40% for local minority businesses. It's really had an impact on keeping dollars here locally. Dr. McCoy, you know, parting words, we're down to probably the last few minutes. Any advice on how people can contact you? If I have an interesting idea, I know that you said that Fayetteville State kind of has something equivalent, but how do I contact you if I need your services?
Well, you know, I'm pretty easy to find. If you go to NCCU School of Business, you know, I lead the entrepreneurship program. If you spell my last name right, McKoy, it's easier to find me, Henry McCoy. And I definitely welcome folks reaching out. I mean, I get a chance to work with folks all across the state, all across the country. One thing I say to something you said, the mayor, which I think is critically important, is, you know, there's a tremendous amount of rescue dollars that are coming down. You know, one of the things that I think is you know, monumentally important is that local governments really be very intentional about how those funds are moved and be very thoughtful. Because, I mean, again, you know, part of the challenge is that when you look at this idea of what's fair and what's not fair, you have to take into account kind of the history of you know, kind of where we are and where we've been. And so, for example, in Durham, there's a group that's working to, you know, try to get a goal of about 45% of those rescue dollars into Black-founded, Black-led organizations with the idea of, you know, really equity. And so, you know, having worked with, you know, cities all across the country and understanding kind of what the challenges are, I do commend you all and you and your thoughts as it relates to, you know, using those rescue dollars to really, you know, help minority local businesses to not only kind of, you know, survive what we've been through and what we're still going through, but then to thrive going forward. Because one thing just to survive is another thing to actually be able to thrive and grow. Because as you know, for better or worse, you know, we want to live in a Pollyannish world, but people tend to, they, you know, to Kevin's point about social capital, they hire people from their networks. And so if we can, you know, make sure these businesses from the community grow, they will tend to reach out and pull in other folks to be a part of that growth. And so I think the rescue dollars offer some great opportunities for that.
Absolutely. Quickly, I kind of forgot about this. Nonprofits. Kevin, do you have any advice for nonprofits? I get a lot of inquiries for nonprofits that look for resources. I know we plan to partner with them in the various areas that we discuss. Any ideas on that?
I think that Fayetteville State could be a good option and resource for that. They may have some words of advice, you know, even through their university center program, they have some words of advice on how to connect nonprofits to resources. I'm not certain what the state is doing, but that could be another option. The Department of Administration may have some information on that. So one thing I do want to, if I could, Mr. Mayor, clarify too, with the Retool MC program, historically underutilized and disadvantaged business enterprises, it's not fully open yet, but it may be very soon. So I'm suggesting to you know, that old or new adage, I don't know if it's old or new, but stay ready so you don't have to get ready.
That's right. That's right.
Get things in order now.
Absolutely. Dr. McKoy, last 30 seconds, nonprofits. I saw you had some background in that.
Yeah, well, I would say just go out there and look at resources. I mean, I'd say look at, for example, Self-Help Credit Union. Mm-hmm. Self-Help, I think, has a presence here in Fayetteville. Self-Help works with a lot of nonprofits. So I think they really moved a lot of PPP dollars to nonprofits, some that I sit on the board of. So I say look at Self-Help Credit Union. And reach out to them, because again, I think they do have a Fayetteville location here.
Well, guys, I thank you so much for joining us. It's so much more I wanted to talk to you about, but I think you've helped tremendously the listeners today on WIDU and those who are joining us on social media. If you could share this conversation, Mayor's Moment, on your social media platform so that we can try to inform and guide as many people to success as possible. Today's focus was on minority and black-owned businesses who have been impacted tremendously. All businesses have been impacted, so we're not in any way lessening the impact that it's had, but there's been significant impact that was backed by statistics that were shared by Kevin that shows that that disproportionately more black businesses closed and will never return back to operation. So we want to make sure that all are successful. We know that the wider the table of success is, the greater, the stronger our community is. Guys, thank you so much for joining us. Dr. Henry McKoy, North Carolina Central University School of Business and Entrepreneurship. Mr. Kevin Digg, President and CEO of Carolina Small Business Development Fund. Thank you for the work you're doing, and look forward to talking to you guys in the future. Thank you for another edition of Mayor's Moment. The City Council will have a meeting tonight to continue moving some of the pieces in place for getting the resources of the American Rescue dollars out. We'll have more information on that and how you apply. But thank you for another edition of Mayor's Moment. See you next Monday if God says the same.
What we know, what we have seen, is that America can change. That is the true genius of this nation. What we have already achieved gives us hope, the audacity to hope, for what we can and must achieve tomorrow.